Welcome to this, I think, what will be an extraordinary panel on human rights and technology. On behalf of the Center for International Studies, I'm John Tierman, and I welcome you to this and future events. Please do check our calendar and sign up on the sheet outside to be notified of Starr forums and other events that we have, some more this spring, and certainly, of course, a full plate in the fall. Today's event is co-sponsored by the Center, and we are particularly happy to have this sterling group of experts with us today. I'm going to introduce the moderator, and he will introduce the speakers. And that is Jay Aronson, who is the founder and director of the Center for Human Rights Science at Carnegie Mellon University. He is also an associate professor of science, technology, and society in the Department of History. His research and teaching focus on the interactions of science, technology, law, and human rights in a variety of contexts. He recently completed a long-term study of the ethical, political, and social dimensions of post-conflict and post-disaster identification of the missing and disappeared, and has been involved in various projects to improve the quality of civilian casualty recording and estimation in times of conflict. His previous research focused on the development and use of forensic DNA identification in the American criminal justice system. His first book, entitled Genetic Witness: Science, Law, and Controversy in the Making of DNA Profiling, examined the development of forensic DNA analysis in the American legal system. His next book, on the recovery, identification, and memorialization of the victims of 9/11 World Trade Center attacks, will be published in the fall. Please join me in welcoming Jay Aronson.
Thanks so much, John. I don't want to put my computer down on here, so excuse me if I hold it. It's truly a pleasure to be here at MIT today. I want to thank the Center for International Studies for inviting us to participate in the Starr Forum, and to Michelle Nook for her help in organizing the event. Today, we're going to talk about the role that technology can play in human rights documentation. And rather than speaking in generalities or promulgating a kind of utopian fantasy that if we can just get the right technology, then an era of perpetual peace will be ushered in, we're going to talk about concrete systems that have been developed to deal with very specific challenges of documenting conflict situations. So our panelists are going to talk about what's possible with these tools, but also their limitations. And you'll hear something about the lessons that have been learned and the challenges that remain moving forward. After they've spoken, I'll give a very brief commentary. I'm not going to say much now. I might not say anything then. I'll have to decide, if I have anything to say. I won't. If I don't, don't worry. And then I'll open the floor for your comments. Each panelist is going to speak for 15 minutes. And in order to keep things moving along, I'm just going to quickly introduce the other panelists now and then let them provide any more background that they think is necessary. So our first speaker is Sucharita Varanasi. She's currently a public finance attorney at Hinckley, Allen & Schneider here in Boston. It's in Boston, right? Okay. Prior to this post, and this is what she's going to be talking about, she worked with Physicians for Human Rights, where she served as the senior program officer for the Sexual Violence in Conflict Zones project. And in this position, she managed the development of the MediCapt sexual violence documentation system, which she'll be describing in her presentation today. Our second speaker is Brad Samuels. He's an architect by training and the founding partner at SITU Research. SITU Research focuses on the development and implementation, among other things, of new strategies for visualizing, mapping, modeling, and analyzing human rights violations in legal and advocacy contexts. Today he'll be discussing efforts to organize and analyze large volumes of video from the Euromaidan protests in Ukraine, and I'm actually quite privileged to be able to work with him on this project, as well as one or two other examples of projects, just to give you a sense of the kind of visualization and analysis that he's doing in a variety of different situations. Our final speaker is Chris McNaboe, who founded and directs the Syria Conflict Mapping Project within Carter Center's Conflict Resolution Program. Chris is a leader in efforts to figure out how to combine evidence gleaned from social media with other data streams to develop an accurate and usable picture of conflict situations. Chris is going to give you a better idea of the kinds of data that he uses, but I would be remiss if I didn't provide a little bit of background, biographical background on Chris. He spent the majority of his childhood abroad, growing up primarily in Saudi Arabia, Indonesia, and Kuwait. Which you might not know just from looking at him. He's fluent in Arabic and regularly returns to the Middle East to meet with contacts who evaluate the work that he's going to show you and give him advice on how to make it more accurate. So again, this isn't just technology kind of telling us something that we blindly believe. It's a combination of the use of technology and human intelligence and judgment and decision making working together, hopefully ultimately making human rights documentation more accurate. So that's all I'm going to say for now, and join me in welcoming Sucharita up to the podium.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. As Jay just said, I am no longer with Physicians for Human Rights. I'm currently at Hinckley Allen & Snyder working as a public finance attorney, which is what I did before I got to Physicians for Human Rights. But I still have a place, I guess, in this space, in that I am currently on the technology advisory board for the Office of the Prosecutor of the ICC. So I try and stay connected that way. So what I wanted to talk today, now that I'm no longer with PHR, is just giving a broader perspective of how to develop technology for a human rights purpose. There are a lot of organizations that are going about this, and they're trying to create technology for a legal purpose. And so I really wanted to talk about some lessons learned in trying to develop this technology and working in a different context than the United States and the Western world. So what I consider that there are five major considerations to develop human rights technology. The first one is understanding why. Why are you developing technology? Technology now is such a buzzword. It's great with funders. Everybody wants to fund it. Everybody wants to put money in it. But really, what does it mean to incorporate technology into human rights work? So we'll explore that through Medicat and what we did with Medicat. The second is knowing the context, and I would say that this is equally as important as the first consideration, but it's so important to understand the context in which you're working and in which you're trying to use the technology. If you don't understand this, if you don't know the context and really understand the players who are going to use the technology, it really makes the technology irrelevant. The third one is acquiring technology expertise. This is an obvious one, and many people would put this as the first consideration, but I really believe that the first two are actually more important. But you know, as a human rights organization or human rights activists, acquiring technology expertise is not as easy as it seems. And so acquiring that, knowing what exactly you're trying to acquire and what expertise you need to have in-house is something that I think is crucial to the successful technology. The fourth one is engaging in co-design and being nimble. And here, you know, co-design, there's some people who teach on co-design here at MIT. I see them in the crowd. So collaborative design, you know, we stumbled upon it with our work with Medicapt. We didn't realize that that's what we were doing. But it has become pretty much a hallmark of how we've continued to develop Medicapt, and I think it should be part of any technology project. and what co-design really means in collaborative design, what that means is incorporating end-user feedback in the actual product design, and making sure that those who are actually using the technology are have a say in how it's developed and the design process. And with that is the ability to also be nimble. And so if you go to the people who are actually going to be using the technology very early on in the process, you then have not invested so much money and resources into the end product such that you can be flexible in how you incorporate that feedback. And then lastly is addressing sustainability. Technology is ever changing, especially with all the security implications and all the various apps and, you know, encryption, and there's so much that's going on. How are you going to make the technology sustainable going forward? You know, it could be relevant right now in this moment in time, but is it going to be able to be used a year from now, 2 years from now? So we can explore and you know, talk about what that means with respect to MediCap. So before I go into the considerations, I just wanted to give a little background as to what MediCap is. So MediCap is a mobile app, it's a smartphone app, that Physicians for Human Rights is currently developing to be able to document sexual violence in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. It's an advanced documentation tool that allows a doctor to input medical information on a smartphone in addition to taking photographs that can then be put together as a record that would then be securely uploaded to a server or cloud. And then the here is actually a better image of how this system is supposed to work. And this is the system in its very simplistic diagram of really what was envisioned at the beginning. So please just bear with me with my stick figures. But so a sexual survivor would present to a doctor, and they would be able to forensically document the sexual violence that had been sustained on their smartphone app. That using MediCap and the transmission, they would be able to transmit that directly to the police, who would have the capability of being able to take that evidence and use it as part of their investigation. And then that information would then be securely transmitted to players within the justice system. So it seems like a great system. In reality, it's a lot more complicated than that. So going back to that first consideration of understanding why, so here are some questions that I think are so relevant to anybody who's just starting out in developing technology. It's like, why are you developing this? What problem are you trying to solve, or what needs are you trying to meet with developing the technology? How will the technology help you achieve the solution to the problem? And I think this is the real crux of this, is that do you need technology to solve the problem? I think so quickly people go right to, yes, technology, and then go right down the path of that's where we need to go. But sometimes technology is not the easiest thing. And as I think you'll get from this talk, that there's so many other implications to incorporating technology into the workflow that I think that's actually the first question you should start with, is do you need it? And really, the question should be like, why do you need it, instead of why we don't need it? Maybe I just said that flip. Yeah, the other way around. It's supposed to be more profound than what I just said, but anyway. Okay, so understanding why for MediCap. So the program on sexual violence and conflict zones at Physicians for Human Rights started in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. The Democratic Republic of the Congo, which I hopefully most of you know, is in Central Africa. It's the second largest country in Africa, the largest sub-Saharan country. It's 11th largest in the world. This becomes relevant in a little bit. It's been ravaged by war for the last several decades, and it's been characterized as the rape capital of the world. These are survivors who are standing outside of a mobile court in Kalehe in South Kivu, and they're waiting for their turn to testify in the mobile court. And this is a rare occurrence. And so while this is great that they have their day in court it rarely comes to this because of this. So there's so many issues with sexual violence, in that there's so much stigma and shame attached to the crime. Survivors are often ostracized for having been sexually violated, and there. So for these women to come to this stage is so important. But the sad thing is that even despite all the courage and bravery that it takes for these women to come forward, so many of these cases fail for lack of evidence. So this is a picture from a Human Rights Watch report. During the Minova trial. And the Minova trial was tried in 2014 for crimes that occurred in November 2012, where the Congolese military there was a 10-day rampage in a town called Minova, and over 70 women and girls were raped, along with 10 days of pillaging of the entire village. And out of the 39 people who were accused of crimes of sexual violence as well as pillaging, only two low-ranking soldiers were found guilty of one account of rape each. So that's what we're, and then this was a trial that actually had a lot of international scrutiny, a lot of international pressure. This actually happened within less than 2 years of the crimes being committed, which is rarely ever happens, and you only had two convictions of two rapes each. So that's what we're dealing with when we talk about impunity and just rampant impunity in the DRC for sexual violence in particular. So what we found with PHR is that the cases fail for lack of evidence. And so as Physicians for Human Rights, we started a training program to help. We started a training program to help physicians in their documentation efforts. And so, how do you properly document a sexual violence crime? So what we found was that forensic medical exams were rarely conducted. Medical charts. Even if an exam was conducted, the medical charts failed to document any findings that could actually be used in court. And so what you see on the right-hand side is an example of a medical chart that they were trying to submit as evidence. It's illegible, it doesn't have all of the proper findings that are necessary to hold weight in court. We also found that doctors were using language that the police and the lawyers and the judges were not understanding. So there was a need for a shared language among all of the actors. And then there was also a need of coordination. You know, what is the role of a doctor? What is the role of the police and law enforcement? And what is the role of the judge or a lawyer? And really having people understand that. And this is in an environment where it's not very cut and dry. The other issue is that storage and preservation of the records and evidence is a huge problem. And so what you see on the right here it was also in the Human Rights Watch report on the Minova trial, but there was only one copy of so much of the evidence for what they used in the Minova trial. It was great that they even got their hands on this one copy of evidence. So many times a case will be tried months, years after the crime has occurred, and when they go back to the doctor to try and find evidence, they don't have a proper record management system, so they're not able to actually locate what has actually been documented. And, you know, sometimes doctors are writing on back of napkins, and, you know, they're trying to make things work, limited resources, but at the end of the day, there's no evidence to be able to support the survivor's claims. And then there's also a lack of resources, and so when we got to Bukavu, along with some of the other areas that we've worked in the DRC, I mean, there's just a lack of resources for doctors to be able to even conduct these medical exams. So what we worked on with our doctors was this app that would at least allow for the standardization of medical information. So if you're able to standardize the way that information is being taken, so first we developed a form, and it was a form that was developed, you know, with the help of doctors, the lawyers, the law enforcement, and then we digitized that form for Medicapt. One of the other things that we realized is that it was really hard for doctors to, while they're trying to document, to also take forensic photographs of the injuries sustained. And here in the DRC, you don't have the benefit of DNA analysis, so that just doesn't even come up as something that could be a possibility in the exam room. So there's a heavy reliance on forensic photography to be able to show injuries sustained during sexual violence. So by merging the two and being able to preserve that and store that for later court or legal purposes was something that is at the heart of Medicapt. And at the time that we were developing this, there was no technology that we could use that could be repurposed to fit our needs of the DRC. So the second consideration is knowing the context. Who's going to use this technology? Where will the technology be used? Is there infrastructure to be able to support this technology? How does the justice process work where the technology will be used? And you think that that would be an easy answer, but it's not. And in a place like the DRC, it's very complicated. They have two different justice systems. They have a civilian justice system as well as a military justice system, which just makes it very complicated. And it's even more complicated as a survivor in trying to navigate that. And then another question for understanding the context is, can technology be inserted into this justice process? And then what are the risks and the threats? When you're trying to understand and use this technology in the place that you want to use it. So one of the things with the DRC is understanding the terrain and just where we're looking to use this technology. The DRC is a vast country. There's at times the roads are impassable to get to some regions. There are a lot of remote areas. There is a lot of, so a survivor sometimes will have to travel miles upon miles to get to a medical facility, and then we'll have to go around and travel miles and miles to get to the nearest police station. And so if you can imagine the evidence having to travel all these different places, you can understand why there's a failure to actually have evidence for these crimes. There are limited resources. This is a medical supply closet that had been ravaged by rebel groups in a city in South Kivu. And there's limited technology infrastructure. And so understanding what that means, you know, it's not like we can have an app working up and going and go to the most remote areas of the DRC and just turn on your phone and start uploading things. So understanding what are the technical limitations to what it is that you're trying to build. And that actually has been a very hard thing to kind of surmount in terms of building Medicapt. And then understanding the culture and the DRC, as well as many other countries around the world, it's a paper-based culture. So this whole idea of that nice image that I showed you at the beginning with it being paperless and everything getting transmitted, that's not how the culture works there yet. So how do you interject technology in a place that is so reliant on paper? And so this has been a fascinating thing, especially with trying to get buy-in from people who were wanting to use this technology is, you know, and so many of them were like, well, where's our paper? Where's what we just inputted into this device? So I just wanted to explain how all of those three different things affected the design of Medicapt. And so one of the considerations that we had to do very early on with Medicapt was being able to use the app offline. And so going to an area and just being able to use it offline, being able to take photographs, being able to store it securely on the device, and then when you get to a point of connectivity, being able to transmit it. The other issue, as I talked about with the technical limitations, is that there is a low bandwidth issue there. So how do you transmit large amounts of data? And so the photographs that actually you need for evidentiary purposes have to be high image resolutions. And so if you have low bandwidth, how do you do that? And so how do you incorporate that into the technology? And so we are using store and forward technology such that whenever you got to a point of connectivity, you would be able to transmit a portion of whatever it is that you're trying to transmit. And then whenever you got to the next part of the next point of connection, you'd be able to transmit the next part. It seems like a simple solution, but again, you know, you have to think about the context in which you're working. And then lastly, it's incorporating printing the paper form. If that's what people wanted, and if that's what they needed at the time to use the technology, then that's what we did. And it seems pretty simple again, but a lot of this is just listening to the people who are actually going to be using the technology. And so we came up with this spectrum of integration where at the most minimal integration, if all we can do is have people input information onto a phone, take photographs of the injuries, and then be able to print, at the very least, we could still preserve this for later court purposes, right? So at the very least, that's what we were thinking. And then if down the line, we can integrate it into the whole Congolese system and be able to transmit it to law enforcement and then transmit it to justice, that's great. But what we were thinking is that at the very least, if we can at least get people to start using it, we could preserve this information for when the survivor would need it the most. So the third consideration is acquiring technology expertise. And so I ask all of you here at MIT, if this is something that's important to you, if you know of your friends who are interested in helping human rights organizations create technology, or if you have solutions to this, you know, there are outlets where I think people would need your expertise. And so one of the things of creating MediCapt was trying to find how we could translate this idea into a technology, in a usable technology, and learning what that language is. And so that gets to the heart of that first question is what technology information or knowledge do you need in order to create the technology that you want? And then do you have the technology expertise in-house or do you have to acquire it? And many times, and with the organizations that I've seen who have been trying to develop technology, they've been using third-party developers. They often don't have the expertise in-house. And that's fine. It's just understanding that that's going to be a different relationship. Who are the technology's actors in the space? So understanding who else is creating technology, is it something that you can piggyback off of? What technology has already been developed is another question. And then can you leverage, use, and repurpose this technology that has already been developed for your needs? And then what are the direct, indirect technology implications that you need to take into account? And so how this translates to MediCapt is that what we did to try and get up to speed as to what was going on in the tech space, and you know, we were human rights activists, so this is not what we do on a daily basis. So we just engaged in extensive networking, just trying to talk to as many people as we could to understand what language we needed to use to express what it was that we were trying to build. We hired a third-party technologist to conduct an extensive landscape review for us and to be able to provide recommendations as to how we should proceed. But we only got to the second stage by trying something. So what we did, so we had a pilot back in January 2014, and we used a third-party software. So we tried to piggyback off of something else that was being done. It was a public health survey app. And we put the form, the medical form, into this app. And at its most, it was 256 screens. And so there was no capability of taking photographs either. So we put this on a phone. We wanted to see what it was that our physicians would say about it. So we tried it out with 8 physicians in Bukavu. And have you ever tried to get through 256 screens? And can you imagine doing that when you have a survivor in your exam room? I mean, it was ludicrous, right? And I mean, and we could have told you that even before, but the point was that it was good to have them try something, and this is where we stumbled upon this idea of co-design. And so they immediately looked at us like we were crazy, and they're like, we are not gonna be able to use this. And so we talked through, like, what would you want in your dream app? And so they gave us a whole list. And one of the things that they actually wanted was a pictogram. And actually on our form, on our paper form, there's a pictogram, so a body image, and the ability to, you know, write on the image and be able to say what injury was sustained at that body part. And so that's what they wanted on their app. So they gave a whole bunch, they gave a whole list, and we came back. And then we're like, we need to get a technologist on board and to really survey what's available, who's building what, who's in this space, is there something that we can repurpose? Because we were not in the business of creating technology. That's not what Physicians for Human Rights did. So we didn't want to go down that path if we didn't have to. And so this technologist really helped us to really navigate this field, to understand what options we had available, whether there was something that we could use, what technology we needed to incorporate into whatever we chose to use. And in the end, at that time, there wasn't anything that we could really repurpose for our needs. And so we went down, so now Physicians for Human Rights is going down the path of creating its app. Some other things in terms of the technology expertise and really understanding it, I mean, data security. You know, you think back to that first image, data security is so important. And, you know, really understanding, I mean, and this is highly sensitive information. So you obviously, the threat is large if somebody had access to this information. So ensuring that you're using proper security measures, ensuring that you're using the proper encryption, the latest encryption necessary was important. Looking at the transmission of data, I talked about that already, and network access in remote areas, and data compression and cloud storage. Cloud storage was another big thing. Trying to explain cloud storage to people who have never really experienced a smartphone before was an interesting thing. But I mean, where does this information get stored? And then when you're looking at it for a legal purpose, can you use information that's stored in a different country and use it for a different forum? And so that was another issue that we had to tackle. I've talked about this already, but engaging in co-design and being nimble. And so one of the benefits, I think, of collaborative design is that by engaging the people who are going to use it, they're going to come up with the best ideas. And so that pictogram that I talked about earlier, that's the highlight of our Medicapped app. I mean, it's pretty fantastic. Like, you look at, you have the app, you have the body image, you're able to tap where on the body the injury was sustained, and a pop-up comes up and you're able to take a photograph of the injury. I mean, that's pretty cool. But that was offered by a physician in the Congo who wanted that. And then, you know, can you quickly and easily incorporate the feedback into the development of the technology? And this, again, we went there January 2014. We had this crazy app that we were trying to use. They told us to go and try again. But we hadn't invested a lot of time and money into it at that point. And so it was easy to do. We weren't wed to this. And so we went back to the drawing table. We got a technologist on board. They did the landscape review. We realized we had to build this in-house. We spent about 2 months building it and went back again to the field and showed them, okay, what do you think about this? We brought it down to 28 screens with multiple questions on a screen, had the pictogram, had the ability to take photographs in a secure manner, and it definitely responded more to what they needed. So, you know, and that was a two-month development timeline. And so we hadn't invested again. Like, if they had said to us, this is not what we wanted, it's not like we had invested years and years upon, you know, this development. Okay, lastly, just talked about all that, addressing sustainability. And so these are the questions that I would think about when you're thinking about sustainability is, how is the technology financed? Who's funding this? If you're a nonprofit, you know, this is a big source of this is a big question. What will you need to put in place to ensure successful use and support of technology? So it's great that we're building this app, but then do we have the infrastructure to be able to support people using technology in the field? Who will manage the technology in the short term and in the long term? You know, now is an organization like Physicians for Human Rights supposed to have a tech support team, in New York? So you start getting into questions of how are you going to operate a mini tech company or tech, you know, organization within a human rights organization? And then how do you incorporate updates if you don't have the expertise in-house? Like, how are you staying up to date on all the security measures? How are you staying up to date on everything and ensuring that what people are using in the field is the best that they can be using? So that's what I had to say. If you want to contact me, please email me, after this. And thank you.
Okay, I'm going to try and get through a fair amount, so let me know if I'm going on too long here. So as Jay mentioned, I'm actually trained as an architect, and I think it's just important to start by saying the sort of human rights work that I'm involved in is a sort of small enclave within our design practice. So it's in the context of design and architecture that we're doing this work kind of from the outside as kind of interlopers. I'm going to focus on citizen documentation in urban environments, which is something that we've been doing casework on lately, mostly focusing on urban contexts and basically the proliferation of video and photos. Even sort of over the past 3 years, we've seen this change pretty radically. A lot of the work we do has to do with sort of event reconstruction, understanding complex environments and space, these are about as complex is a case as we've ever sort of encountered in urban environments over long periods, sometimes months, sometimes just hours. But the idea of taking all the videos, all the photos that are coming out of protests and sort of civic activism and doing something with them is basically the challenge we're trying to address. And internationally, both and domestically as well, I mean, Occupy and Ferguson, et cetera. And this is at the same time that we've definitely seen a kind of a lot of advancement in streaming apps, and I think this is being streamed on Periscope. It's just to say that this is going to become more and more true, that sort of all these events are going to become more heavily documented, more accessible, et cetera. Also kind of best practices, organizations like Witness are there to kind of help people organize and figure out how to document accurately in ways which will have use for accountability. So I'm going to start by just talking about a project we worked on a few years ago because I think it's an interesting precedent that ramps up really fast to much more complex environments. This is a case we worked on in the West Bank. The guy in the yellow shirt's name is Bassem Abu Rahma. He was involved in a peaceful protest in the village of Bilin. And he was shot in the chest with a gas canister, a tear gas canister, during one of the protests there. We were engaged by the attorneys that were representing his family, as well as B'Tselem, which is a human rights organization. So usually we come in as a kind of constellation of actors that usually involves legal counsel and a human rights organization, and this is certainly the case here. So what do we, you know, what is the kind of data that we're given? And I'd say, we're not developing software. We're really misappropriating and kind of leveraging what already exists. And we're often getting very, very diverse data to kind of to work with each case. So here, specifications on the munition that struck Bassem, photographs from the day of the event. And I should say, the legal brief was also very clear. The attorneys were arguing that the IDF soldiers that shot him were in breach of open fire regulations that state very clearly you have to fire these munitions at above 60 degrees. They're sort of so-called less lethal munitions that descend into crowds, release gas. And on that day, there was a lot of these 40 millimeter canisters being shot directly at protesters. So it's a breach of open fire regulations. And that was the legal question that we had to kind of address. So here, in terms of the citizen video, I'll show you. I'll just let it play, and I think it'll become clear in a minute why. It's a little graphic, a warning. So I think as will be clear, it's the exact same moment in time, shot from three different cameras, just synced. And none of them capture both the soldier that was firing and the victim, but all of them, you know, capture the event from different vantages. This guy, David Reeb, is a videographer who's capturing this footage here. And then from farther back, there's somebody on it who has a tripod who's capturing this. And so this is part of the data we were given to work with to see if we could address this sort of fundamental legal question they were asking about open fire regulations. And one of the first things we did was to just try and sync the footage. And in this case, it was just three videos. And that's important for the Maidan work I'll show you in a moment. So in addition to the videos, there's a lot of photos as well. It's not just moving image, but stills. And that becomes important. Also, here you can see someone from downhill captured the moment that Bassem was struck in a series of photos. And that becomes very important also because it allows us to understand where David Reeb was standing when he was videotaping the event as well. So what are we doing with this information? So this is where some of the software we're using in our, you know, as a design office becomes useful. This is just modeling kind of key components of the site. And we're, of course, working at a distance in Brooklyn, so we're in close communication with the folks at B'Tselem who are measuring features of interest on the site and sort of answering queries as they come up. So positions of IDF soldiers, positions of Abu Rahma and Reeb, the videographer, the fence. The IDF, in the middle of our report, came out with a statement saying that, in fact, the canister had struck the fence and ricocheted and then hit Bassem, which is actually an argument that they frequently come up with when gas canisters hit people. So modeling the fence was important. This was a parametric model, so this was just I'm not going to get too deeply into this, but this is just a tool that allows us to visualize very quickly something which is super obvious, but which is critical in a legal context, which is just to say these munitions travel 100 years when they're fired in accordance with open fire regulations. And just to look at that in relation to where we know Bassem was standing and where the IDF soldiers were positioned. So again, you know, super obvious, but necessary. And the last little piece of this I'll show you is so also, as we're working on this, Sarit Mikhaili, who's the press officer at B'Tselem, realizes that in a single frame of the video, you can actually see the trajectory of the munition. And this becomes actually incredibly useful for us in terms of addressing the question of angle of fire. You know, mining the video footage is incredibly important for this work, but becomes exponentially more difficult the more videos you have. It's not just the more videos you have, the better documentation you have, it's more work in a lot of ways. So again, I'm not going to get deeply into this, but this is just the kind of analysis that went into the report that we filed that was part of the petition to reopen the case. It was a military tribunal, so this went to the judge advocate general at the IDF, and the case was reopened as a result. And I'll just call your attention here to the format, which is, I think Sutrita mentioned this as well, is that, you know, we're a bit beholden to the context in which the legal proceedings are happening. So in this context, it had to be a PDF. It had to be, you know, printable 8.5 by 11. So anything that was kind of dynamic or better understood and through time had to be reduced to very, you know, still images, 7 minutes. Okay. So form, just maybe just keep in mind the idea of format and how it plays into all of this. So, with this kind of, having worked on this project, the case that we're now working on with Jay Aronson and with Alex Hauptman at Carnegie Mellon is focusing on the Maidan protest, and specifically one day of February 20th, 2014, when there were 49 civilians killed and 3 military killed. The protests have been going on since November 2013, but that was the deadliest day, and that was the day before Yanukovych fled in exile and is the subject of a legal case. So we are working for Pavel Daikon and Alexandra Yatsenko, who are the lawyers, again, who are representing families of people that were killed. And it's kind of the same problem set. It's event reconstruction. But it's the difference is there's hundreds of videos and there's thousands of photographs. And while you might think that would be helpful, it's actually difficult because it's almost prohibitively time. It's absolutely prohibitively time consuming to go through all of it. So this is the kind of video that we've been given, that we have a lot of, rather. And one thing that's kind of interesting to note or important to note is that because this protest, like the last one I showed, was going on for, because it was going on for months, everyone was really well organized, and that meant there was so much more video, and there was so many more photos, and you can see even people were, it is a sort of post-apocalyptic scene, as I'm sure you guys are all aware, and people had battle armor on that were, you know, it just meant that there was, it was very well organized in some way. And so a lot of citizen video, a lot of network footage, but in terms of trying to make sense of the actual events of that day, what we were seeing when we were asked to start this work and the scholarship on it and the analysis of it was that it was incredibly complex to try and draw and visualize and understand. And this is some of the diagrams that were coming out of people that were trying to do that. It's just very hard to read. And we think, not that useful in this format. So what are we doing? Basically, the problem set is, again, issued by the attorneys. It's not for us to kind of figure out what it is we're looking for, but for them to tell us what it is we're trying to reconstruct. So they're trying to identify locations and times of civilians that were killed, civilians that were injured, and also military. There are different groups of military personnel and where they were at different points during the day. In terms of the raw data we're getting, and this is really important for how we're working with Jay and Alex on this, this is what we're getting. It's no sort of standardization in terms of naming conventions, every different types of format, a ton of information to go through, and again, prohibitive. But ultimately, we are looking for a kind of global clock, that is to say, the time that the video is shot, and also a location. So we can begin to understand in space where it occurred in time in relation to other videos. Geospatial information is something that was also really important in terms of a starting point. And then looking at clusters, and I think the conceit here is that we're not going to be able to reconstruct all 49 deaths, both because it's we don't have the personnel to try and do that, but also because not everything is documented equally. So we're looking at kind of clusters of events and trying to rationalize it in manageable ways. And I'll just make this show this very quickly. This is the workflow. I think is kind of interesting here because this is footage that was synced by people that were participating in the protests. So someone took, I think, like 9 months. An individual took 9 months to look at this for kind of key events, sounds, and was able to sync. You see in the upper left the time elapsing. So we have, in some sense, all of the footage synced, or a lot of it, not all of it. What she didn't do is keep a kind of spreadsheet which correlates video footage to names of files. So if we say we want that video, we have no way of knowing which file it belongs to, which was a serious problem. But this was a really important part of the workflow, nonetheless. They also went through, the same group of activists in Ukraine went through and identified movements of police and also of moments and videos in which you can see people being killed. So I'd say that's the kind of activist end of the analysis. On the other end is the automation. And this is a presentation from Alex and Jay, where they are basically trying to automate some of the syncing, the geolocation and the global clock. So here they're looking at audio signatures, and basically lining up footage where they coincide in terms of time. This is a bit the workflow. I'm not going to get, you know, this is Alex and Jay could explain this better than I could, but this is, Alex could explain it very well. But basically looking at audio signatures and from that, with one, you know, if you have one ground truth, you can begin to kind of sync the rest of the footage around it. So that gives us the time it was shot. And then location, this is really super interesting as well. Alex's team is basically ripping keyframes from the video footage and then comparing them to street views in Google. And so they can, you know, through computer vision algorithms and just basically identify key, the same monuments in location, then you get your latitude and longitude. So what we end up getting eventually is a spreadsheet that looks like this. We have our location, we have our global clock, and then we can put that into our interface, which is basically the report structure, which looks like this. So a kind of introduction section, a 1 minute. Let me just open this real quick. A component which kind of breaks down very kind of succinctly kind of key events and key moments, and I'd say in a more curated way. But this is the part I think would be the most useful to show you. This is basically the, on the bottom is basically all of the videos that we currently have, and it's just a fraction of the total. So I think we've got another 200 to add to this. Basically, as you slide around, you should be able to view. It's not working, I'm sorry. I'll show you here. You can view the videos on the upper right, and you can kind of, you know, you can query by time and by location. So the map will locate where the videos were shot, the time will show you when they were shot, and on the upper right, you can basically select the videos, and they will, you know, they'll play. So if you're interested at a specific location, all the dots on the map are locations where people were killed. So this is a way of kind of beginning to assemble content in the way that was useful to us in the past case in Belin, in a platform that can be useful for event reconstruction in a much more complex and dynamic situation. I'll leave it there. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I think that is actually a pretty good segue into what I'll be talking about here. So for those of you who followed the protests and events of Ukraine, it was tumultuous, but it was also relatively short. What we've been working on at the Carter Center is Syria, which is like Ukraine, but has continued on for over 5 years now. By my own calculations and estimates based upon the archives and databases that people have put together, it's my belief that there are more minutes of video than of real time that have elapsed in Syria. So utilizing similar sources of information, what we've been doing at the Carter Center is trying to make as much sense of the conflict as possible in order to better inform peacemakers, negotiators, and also humanitarian organizations on how to respond to conflict. So to put that in a little bit of context, this started, the project started in the very beginning of 2012. And at the time, I was at the Carter Center, and I was tasked with generally just understanding what was going on in Syria, figure it out. At that time, things were really starting to heat up. Protests had been going on since 2011. Things were turning increasingly violent, and we started to see more and more defections from the military. Now, what was interesting about these defections is they took place on YouTube. Defectors decided that was the best place for them to announce their defection. They could hold up their ID card. They could tell everything that they needed to tell their audience, confirm their defection, and then hopefully promote further defections. So by the summer, so this was really interesting. It started to be something that I would document. By the summer of 2012, it documented 14,000 defectors and people that had joined up with the armed opposition. Not all military, some civilians that were joining up with these soldiers. Now, when people defected, they gave their name, their rank, their division, reasons for defecting, which allowed us to really start to put together a story. It was which ranks are defecting, what divisions in the military are defecting, Is this going to continue? Is the Syrian military going to collapse in any fundamental way? And then more importantly, where people were going to. So this became fundamentally important for our understanding of the conflict, because at the time, and even today, there's an ongoing debate of, well, you know, who is the opposition? Do we support the opposition? What are their motivations? What do they actually want? Who's in charge? Who speaks for them? When you start to put together these little bits of information about where people are going when they defect, or what these armed groups are doing, you can begin to answer some of those questions. So what started with an effort to document defections from the military became an effort to document new armed group formations. And this time lapse that I'm about to show you shows exactly that. Each dot is an armed group, and it shows over the course of 2 years, armed group formations in just one of Syria's 14 governorates. Let's see. That first tiny dot is the first armed group to form in Aleppo. Then there were two, four, then quite a few more. So the larger dots here are groups that are more important in the overall network of armed groups. Colors, different colors represent clusters of armed groups that are networked together. So here we have one cluster. They're subsidiary to this blue cluster. All of these dots in the center are groups that were formed independently, and you'll see them eventually sometimes be pulled out to the side as they link up with other groups. So this was an effort to, similar to what Brad was doing with these videos, pull just relevant bits of information about hierarchical structures. So one group forms, they say they're subsidiary to another group, that's two different nodes. This is, like I said, this is just one of Syria's 14 governorates, and it's just the first 2 years of the conflict. We're, as I mentioned earlier, over 5 years into the conflict now, so you can imagine the complexity that we're dealing with now. Taking a look at all governorates together during that time period, you see something that looks like this. Very interesting, pretty visual, but to a negotiator or a mediator, it might as well be a plate of spaghetti or some giant hairball, because you're never going to be able to make sense of this. That is what we started with, this massive amount of information on who is who and who's doing what in the country. The immediate question then became, okay, we've got all this information on groups that are forming and subsidiary to who, but they can't all be active independently. What about that first dot that formed, that very first group? Is it still active? Should we even still have it on this map? How do we get rid of the irrelevant information, right? How do we narrow it down to just the most important people, just the most active people? And that meant that we had to broaden the information that we were collecting. So still looking at mostly social media sources, YouTube videos, and Twitter accounts and Facebook pages and things like that, we started broadening our research and collecting information on conflict events and linking them to the groups that we knew existed. In this way, we could have a timeline of participation of many of these different groups. If somebody ceases to be active, we can remove them from our network and keep an evolving network of groups that were relevant to the conflict. Now, after being working on this project for over 4 years now, we track five main aspects of the conflict. Armed group formations and relations, conflict events, so any recorded or stated instance of force-on-force clashes, artillery shelling, aerial bombardments, improvised explosive devices, you name it, we enter it into our database and we link it to any group that we can as a target of the attack, the initiator of the attack, any other groups that were mentioned, and we keep, as much as we can, a timeline on who's doing what. We also track sightings of sophisticated weaponry as an indication of foreign support. A lot of this information comes through videos, and if you start adding that to your network, if you start color-coding your network according to what groups have a particular foreign-supplied weapon, it can tell you a little bit about those structures and how those hierarchies are actually working, how those groups are coordinating with each other, and can better inform you about how to then engage these groups on a conflict resolution basis. That is that's the focus of the Carter Center. Thankfully for us, it makes our work a lot easier that we are not engaging in prosecution of war crimes. We're not engaging in documentation of human rights. We're simply trying to end the conflict. Understand the actors, understand the interests, understand the networks and relationships that exist between people so you can more effectively engage them in negotiations. So you understand who it is that's sitting around a table. More recently, in the past year, we've also been documenting movements of civilians and assessments of humanitarian living conditions. So this comes from networks of contacts that we have within the country. Putting all this information together is great, and it leads to some pretty visualizations, but how do we make it actionable to those that are dealing with this? How do we make it actionable to the mediators, to the humanitarian organizations? And this has been the main focus of our work so far. Certainly, we can collect a whole bunch of data, but as you can see in Brad's presentation before, piecing it together and getting the information out to somebody who can do something with it on an A4 piece of paper or 8.5 by 11 is really what makes things impactful. So we were lucky to partner with Palantir Technologies. They granted us access to their analytic platform, which allowed us to put together all the various pieces of information and start developing some of those 8.5 by 11 main takeaways to give to the United Nations, the mediators, to the humanitarian organizations. Just a few weeks ago, we released this. This is live. It's up on our website. It's near real-time auto-updating map of front lines throughout the conflict. You can, I encourage you to go play around with it. You can scroll backwards and forwards through time. And what this shows is really just filtered out location capture events. We focus on videos and statements that people have made that show a change in the front line. We code all the, each dot on here is a population center, or in some cases major military installations, but generally just population centers. You code it by who controls it, and when you get new information, you can update the properties of that city or town with who controls it now. By keeping track of this information, we're able to just share this relevant subset of our database to the mediators. You can see how things are progressing, you can see how things are changing, and you can better respond to it. For the humanitarian organizations in tracking civilian displacements and such, we developed a different tool. This is our early warning system. And what we did here is we looked at all of the different conflict events that we were collecting, about 3,000 per month, and tried to pull out relevant bits of information. Again, that's sort of a one sheet of paper that you can hand to somebody and make actionable. Relevant conflict trends that we had noticed and our humanitarian organization partners had noticed preceded a displacement of civilians. So in this case, as you can see on the left side, these are things like barrel bombings. Any location that witnessed barrel bombings that hadn't seen barrel bombings in the preceding 10, 20 days within a 10 kilometer radius. You can tweak all of the attributes and you can just pull out the relevant bits of information. Location captures, of course, whenever there's a frontline change that leads to civilian displacements, new areas targeted by aerial bombardments, and so on and so forth. And that information then goes out to humanitarian organizations. More recently, for those of you who've been following Syria, as of February 27th, a cessation of hostilities went into effect. It did not include the so-called Islamic State, ISIS, ISIL, Daesh, whatever you want to call it, or Jabhat al-Nusra, and a few other groups that were UN-sanctioned or UN-recognized terrorist organizations. But violence still continued. There have been repeated violations of the cessation of hostilities, even more accusations of violations. So what we have started doing more recently is taking that information, filtering out events that involve those groups that are not part of the ceasefire, such as ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra, and showing on a map instead events that we have recorded through social media, through activist reporting networks, that may be violations of the ceasefire. So this here, this is an image of Aleppo City, a road that goes down towards Damascus. And each point here is a potential violation of the ceasefire that we have documented. The heat map underlying shows the frequency of events in that area. This this set of events in particular is just last Saturday and Sunday. The beginning of April, there was a rise in violence. And we can then pull out those relevant bits of information and share them with the task force that's dealing with this this conflict. Looking at it a little bit more closely, you can even color code those events according to the initiator of those events. Now, this is still, so in this example here, this is a close-up of Aleppo City. Red triangles, triangles are airstrikes. Red is government or pro-government initiated airstrikes. Green is opposition initiated events. Circles are shelling, squares are clashes. And you can just filter through these events and try and share the relevant information. This is an overview of the country and all the events that took place during that same time period. You can begin to see where some of the fighting is focused and where you need to look a little bit more closely. Now, this quick overview of all these different tools, the technology exists that can enable more effective responses or a better understanding of what's going on in the conflict. It's certainly not a silver bullet. It's not perfect. The information coming through social media is biased, and it's not just a lens to view the conflict. It's actively changing the conflict itself. There's a reason that people turn to YouTube to defect. There's a reason that people are uploading all of these videos. You get less information coming out of Islamic State-controlled areas. You get less information coming out of government-controlled areas. Understanding how this information is affecting the conflict helps us also in responding to it. It helps us anticipate the biases that might exist in the data and better present those that information to people that are responding to the conflict itself. I think we're running out of time here a little bit. I'm happy to answer other questions related to this. In closing, just on the ceasefire portion of things, I think that the availability of this information is a real paradigm shift in the way in which people will go about not only engaging in conflict, but reacting to it. You heard about all the difficulties of getting information in Congo and dealing with the potential violations that may have occurred there. The situation of Ukraine and Syria is an overabundance of information. And it really, I think, will be the future of conflict. The conflict will take place in a digital space as much as it takes place in a physical space. And if we can start beginning to bridge the gap between the practitioners on the political side of things and the people who are really working with technology and data and statistics now and dealing with it as we're learning the process, then subsequent conflicts and subsequent interventions that take place in such a connected environment, I think will benefit overall. Thank you.
So we're going to come sit up front. I just wanted to make a couple of quick points. I'm just going to read them so I don't go on, and then we'll open it up. I think one thing that I wanted to just really amplify is Sucharita's point that technology development has to be led by human rights, conflict monitoring, or humanitarian goals. Those of us who are interested in technology development need to listen to what the people actually out in the field need. And I just like that tech expertise comes third in Sucharita's list of what you need, asking why and understanding the conflict, understanding the context are incredibly important. The humanitarian, human rights, or conflict monitoring goal should always be the end point of what you're doing, never innovation or creating a shiny new tool for people that you think they need. So I run something called the Center for Human Rights Science at Carnegie Mellon, and we engage in creating partnerships between members of the human rights community, human rights practitioners, and technologists, mostly computer scientists and statisticians, but a few others. And it's really about creating collaboration so that the human rights folks can explain what goes on out in the field, and the tech folks can say, well, listen, this is what we have, this is what's possible, and then you kind of get into a process of co-design. And this is kind of the work that we're doing with Brad and many others out in the field. There's a lot of technology out there that can benefit. It's just a matter of identifying it and making it work well for the human rights community. There are some cases where, you know, that's not entirely the case, but I would argue even in Sutridza's case, the vast majority of problems have already been dealt with in other contexts, and you might need to tweak or modify or rethink the solutions, but it's not like you have to reinvent the wheel every time you go out and help a human rights group. There's so much duplication in the technology and human rights landscape, so I would urge any of you who are tech-oriented people who want to get involved to integrate yourself into the human rights community and the community of people who are trying to work with them in the tech community, because we don't need 10,000 more apps. There are so many apps for recording and storing video. None of them are perfect. They all have challenges, and we need to perfect what we have rather than innovating. And I just think, you know, I wanted to really amplify Chris's question about how technology, social media, and data analysis will actually change how we wage, monitor, and react to conflict. I think those of you who are political scientists, I would love to talk more about that. I think that's a really key point. We tend to take the information kind of for granted, like, oh, there's all this information coming in, but it's not just coming in. People are producing it and disseminating it for a reason, and we need to understand that as we analyze and evaluate it. So I'll just stop there and then open it up. Yeah.
Interesting question. Was really fascinating.
Maybe just pass it around.
Yeah. Pass it around?
Yeah.
Okay.
I really appreciate the information that you gave. Two, I think, really important questions that I'd like to ask you about. Trying to determine the validity, reliability of the data you get, like weather, has been very unpredictable, and it's been getting increasingly predictable, and we're reaching a pretty good level. But that same kind of question is validity and the reliability of the information that you get. How do you determine that? And the second question is really, I think, a fascinating question is, you disseminate that information, some people then take that information and do something with it, like perhaps some rebel forces or government forces who have access to it and say, because I see this and I accept it as being valid, therefore we're going to do something which then should impact the new data that you collect. So it's a continuous feedback loop. And do you do anything to see if there's any kind of a feedback with that?
Very, very good question. So when it comes to reliability and validity of data, it's very, very difficult to confirm or verify a lot of the information that comes in. If you have a video, then you can do you can use some of the methods that Brad was talking about. You can place it on a map using satellite imagery. Sometimes you can get a date. Sometimes you just have to go with what date it's been uploaded. But if somebody tweets something, there's really no way that you can confirm it. Oftentimes they're using a proxy server, they're tweeting somewhere else, and you can't even get a location on it. So what we focus on is not verification, but rather corroboration of information. And for many of the events that we get in our database, it's very difficult to verify them. But for the main events, so for example, the location capture, the events that go into our front lines dashboard, if somebody captures a location, they will report it. Activists will report it as well. You'll get that information from multiple different sources. They really like to, the capturing party really likes to show off the fact that they're making military gains. There's an incentive there. And oftentimes we'll also get a reported displacement of civilians as a result of that. So when you look at the data from multiple different sources, you can generally layer them on top of each other and increase your confidence in the information that's coming through. It's something that we're still working on. We're trying to sync it up.
It's a hard task because
very much
fake data in order to send it out and then
exactly. And that leads into your second question, which is the feedback from what people are seeing on the ground. There's always an attempt to doctor some of the information that's coming out. For major events, like I was saying, it's difficult to do that. But for small events, it's not. And many of these armed groups have realized that people are watching what they're doing. That's why they're putting the information out there. You know, in the beginning of the conflict, you can have a group of 20 guys in the middle of nowhere in Syria who would have remained utterly anonymous. But the fact that they're putting videos up there has meant that they've been able to connect with funders and donors and suppliers, and they then increase in relevance. In seeing the feedback, we've seen some armed groups fake having anti-aircraft missiles. And if I were an armed group and I'm being repeatedly bombed, I want people to think that I have the capacity to take down a jet. It wasn't true, you know, and the data shows that. It shows repeated aerial bombardments on their location. If they did have anti-aircraft capabilities, they would have used them. But they have an incentive in faking that information. So there is a feedback, we do see that, and really the only way we can do it is try and bring in as many different sources as we can to corroborate and to make the misinformation be seen as the outlier that it is.
So just a really quick addition to that, there are three really good sources for verification in this context. One is Citizen Evidence Lab from Amnesty International. One is First Draft News, which is a coalition of media groups. And the third one is the Verification Handbook. There's a proliferation of verification of this kind of data. Not perfect, and I think corroboration is the way to go. Yeah. But there is a big movement to standardize these things.
And people have worked with that in Syria. There are plenty of activists. I mean, if you just look up some of these videos in Syria, I encourage you, go to Google Translate, type in a couple of keywords, and then just enter them into YouTube and see what comes back. There are people who have taken their camera phones and stared down the barrels of tanks that are shooting at the apartment building that they're in. They want this information to get out to the world, and they want to do whatever they can to verify it. And they have been trained by some of these resources that are out there, such as the Verification Handbook as well.
Hi, I'm Sasha Costanza-Chalk. I'm an associate professor of civic media here and co-PI at the Center for Civic Media. Thank you for a really excellent set of presentations. You've given us a lot of food for thought. I also teach the co-design studio in civic media here at MIT, and so we partner with community-based organizations and we develop civic technologies with them. So it's really exciting actually to hear both of you talking about projects where you're using co-design processes and really integrating that into the core of what it means to do technology for human rights. And I hope that that's a perspective that's growing, and I'd love to actually hear your reflections a little bit more on what it will take to mainstream that approach from the side of the human rights community. I have a sense of what it takes to move it through tech spaces. So I'm curious about your reflections on whether you get pushback, whether you feel like that's something that's growing in prominence. And actually, I really want to focus on that question, but I have to just sort of say, like as a side note, I'm really, really troubled by the work that you're doing, the Carter Center, the partnership with Palantir. I feel like, so first of all, that's a technology firm who was developed by, and their primary clients are all the various branches of the intelligence agencies. They work closely with NSA, CIA, DHS, et cetera, et cetera. They were involved in the H.B. Gary thing where they were developing a strategy for mapping the WikiLeaks networks and targeting them to eliminate the possibility of leakers who are trying to expose human rights violations. I mean, it's a whole can of worms. So I'm really, it's very sexy technology. I understand the impulses behind doing what you're trying to do, but maybe I could frame this in a different way. I think there are a lot of unintended consequences of the type of work that you're doing. And if I'm the Syrian state, I'd be really excited to get access to that network map that you're producing. And probably the primary outcome of that type of process is going to be powerful actors who get better information about less powerful actors and can figure out who they need to target first. So I really, I think that's a real problem. To sort of broaden that out, I think as technologists engage in human rights work, we really need to think carefully about the unintended consequences of using, yes, open source information, which is out there, but the ways that we map it and produce actionable information on it, and think about who's going to have access to that. So I know you want to respond to that, but I really do want to hear more about the co-design piece, maybe after you respond.
You should definitely take that.
Okay.
Sorry.
And I'll say a bit about that.
You want to say a bit about
that? No, I want you to say, then I'll say something.
Okay. We've gotten that response from quite a few people about Palantir's history. They have had relations, and they do still have relations with some government entities and intelligence. And they've been used for quite a few things that I think some people might find questionable. The network maps and everything that you showed, that I showed there, are not done with Palantir. Those are done with open source tools, some of which were coded by us and programmed by us as well. All of the information that we've been putting out there we were using Google Earth, we were using Google Maps, we were using a whole bunch of different tools, but Palantir's help has really been useful in just having an integrated platform. You can feel uncomfortable about the tool or where it comes from. The increased capacity and the information going to people that are responding to the conflict in a positive way is good. If we are going to be keeping information like this anywhere, I think there's something to be said for keeping it in a system that has security at its core and that is trusted by government agencies for keeping the information secure. I don't want to put that on any open source or NGO coded platform either. Not that we're keeping particularly sensitive information either, but I think Palantir has. I think they've been doing a lot of really good stuff in terms of responding to humanitarian crises, tracking sex trafficking, anti-sex trafficking, and an increasing number of philanthropic engagements. It's a relatively light lift for them to provide a platform for a humanitarian organization to use, and it doesn't involve any of the duplication that we were talking about earlier.
It provides a nice PR boost for a firm whose entire history is bound up with working with intelligence services to create actionable information for armed conflict.
The core of Palantir's technology was developed by people who were looking at fraud detection for just financial networks, and that's where the bulk of their money comes from today. Okay.
I think this is a great question. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of what I try and do at Carnegie Mellon is to level the playing field between intelligence, military, corporate actors, and the human rights community, and that often means taking technology developed in those contexts and porting it over in various ways to the human rights community. So what Brad was talking about, a lot of the kind of thinking that went into the technologies that we're developing was funded by IARPA and NSF and corporate actors. And the first thing I asked Chris when he showed me Palantir the first day was, are you crazy? This is the stuff that the military is using. And then I actually thought about it and I realized that most of what I'm doing with my colleagues in computer science and statistics to a lesser extent, is taking government-funded software and making it available in a useful, understandable way for human rights community. So I think we should never stop asking this question, but I don't think that we should say, well, if it's funded by IARPA, then it's dirty. Because the internet is Office of Naval Research, and it's government at its core. So we need to try, I think we need to keep our end goals in mind while we're thinking about all of these things. But I don't think it should be the thing that prevents us from using a tool.
I really don't want to monopolize the conversation, but I feel like you're misrepresenting. I mean, they have ongoing active contracts for information sharing. They're active, but all of those agencies are active clients. Now, it's not just that where the technology came from, it's the current existing processes of data sharing and acquisition and analysis that they're engaging in with a party with armed conflict.
Same with Amazon, unfortunately. It's a challenge.
I could take the co-design question. I won't take the other one. With co-design, I think that human rights principles kind of go in line with co-design. I mean, it's just a very easy
I don't think it's a hard sell at all. You're really incorporating, really what you're saying is that people who are using it, it's kind of a democratic principle, really, is that the people that you're trying to get to use the technology have a say in how it looks and how it's processed and how it's designed. So I think it goes part and parcel with the human rights framework. And so I think if you're building human rights technology or technology to be used for a human rights purpose, having the central tenet be that those who are using it should have a say in how it is developed, it just seems to go with it. I don't think it's a hard sell at all. I mean, if anything, I think the way to talk about it is that by using co-design, you are incorporating human rights principles in the actual development of the technology.
Yeah, I mean, the Maidan case is actually really interesting for us in terms of co-design. Actually, co-design is not a term I'm very familiar with, but I'm assuming it means collaboration between across disciplines and the creation of a tool collectively. And I think it's an interesting example because automation is not going to solve that problem by itself. But it gets us, it lets us even start it, right? Without the ability to crawl through all those videos and begin to say, like, these 300 are here and are taken at this time, it's not even something that could be entertained as an analytical problem set. So that's, I think, interesting example of the kind of potentials and limitations of automation. And at the other end, you have the activists on the ground who are, like, literally watching videos for months, giving you information that nobody else could possibly give you, right? And then we're in the middle as sort of, it's almost like a coordinator role, creating a platform to kind of host this information. So to me, it's a really interesting and I think strong example. Also, I think, this is sort of technical and the competencies are complementary, but the kind of territory is also complementary because the other side of this, and the biggest obstacle I've seen in human rights contexts for this type of collaboration is also just territoriality. Quite frankly, between Amnesty, between Human Rights Watch, and everybody gets together and wants to, it's kumbaya, and then you go away, and no one wants to work with each other. So I think that when things are really complementary, there's a huge potential for kind of integrating them into better tool sets.
Yeah, okay, a question. Kenneth Oy, Center for International Studies, MIT. My question is really on the political implications of what we've just heard. We've heard about methods of documentation, visualization, and dramatization. And in terms of political effect, we also fully appreciate or understand that the difference between an eyewitness or a text-based account or a still photograph by a press photographer is pretty different from video or from the web-based images that we're talking about here. B'Tselem was handing out video cameras precisely to increase that effect. Now, the question is that from the perspective of those that wish to use these tools to influence events, largely a question of accountability, what can they do to increase the credibility or auditability of what they do? The accusation is always it is unrepresentative, it is faked, and sometimes it is. So what do you recommend to those that are using these tools in order to increase accountability, to make it easier for external auditors to determine that what they're doing is in fact something that is truthful in a sense?
So, can I just divide that question up into two things? I think the verifiability question is largely a technology question. There are a lot of tools now that exist that allow you, in theory, to verify. But I think the bigger question, what you asked us, is how representative is the information?
That's right. And that's not.
And so it's a very different problem. A truthful account of a situation could not be representative at all. If I have my camera and I'm saying this is the crowd that came to see me, well, what about all of you over here? And so I think. We're working with statisticians and groups that do this kind of analysis at Carnegie Mellon, one representative here, to try and say, well, how representative is this information? What are we missing? Trying to estimate what we're missing using statistical techniques. But I think that you can have 100 verified, truthful, absolutely accurate accounts, and still not have the whole picture, because there are some groups that are going to use the technology more strategically than others, and some individuals who might not have access at all, and others who might understand how to tell a story visually and who can make a more powerful video or a more powerful account. So I don't think that verifiability will automatically lead to representation. And I think this is something that we should never, ever, 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 ever forget, that technology doesn't produce representation. It produces an account. And so we need to understand how to put these accounts together in a way that is actually representative. I think Chris, Chris, I'm actually curious to hear how you answer this, because, you know, there's a certain point at which, you get so much data that you kind of are forced to believe it, but you don't know what you're still missing.
Yeah, that certainly is a big problem with us. I mean, we get this is one thing that's come up with casualty reporting, and it's something that we're working with actually one of the audience members here on. So many people are reporting on casualties. It looks really good. You know, you're getting four different organizations providing a whole bunch of information, but the overlap between it. Sometimes it's great and sometimes it's not, and you have to use a lot of statistical methods to project outwards. For what we work with is we really just try and say we're very conservative in what sort of estimations we make. We're not trying to track levels of violence. We're not saying that we're tracking levels of violence. What we look for is presence or absence of reports of certain types of incidents in a place on a given day, and try and look at that over time. It works for what we're doing. We're not trying to keep track of casualties. We're not trying to keep track of anything numerically, though. What we're trying to do is gather what information exists and supplement your understanding of the conflict with all of the caveats that it does have. As I mentioned, when it comes to Syria, we get reduced information coming out of Islamic State-controlled areas, government-controlled areas, Kurdish-controlled areas. Actually, in the beginning of the conflict, I attempted to just use Twitter data to analyze what was going on. And I found that taking the full fire hose of tweets coming out of Syria and plotting the approximately 1% that had latitude, longitude, what we got was an almost perfect map of areas of government control. Meaning there were no geolocated tweets coming out of any areas of opposition control, and it was like right along the front lines in the major cities where there was a dense number of tweets, realizing that and looking at that is something that we are very conscious of, and it's something that we try and get through our reporting to. The people that are acting upon it. You know, if we're sending a report up to the United Nations, something they'll ask me all the time is like, okay, how many events did you record? Well, that's irrelevant. I can't give you a number, because if it goes up or down, you're going to think the conflict's going up or down, when all it is we're collecting more or we're collecting less, or there is more or there is less. It is a big problem, but if you integrate some of those questions, or if you integrate some of those kind of conservative approaches to dealing with biased data right in the very beginning, then I think some of it translates up as well.
So I think we're going to take, should we take one or two more questions? Two more questions because of time, and I'm going to have to dash out. I have a plane to catch, so I'd love to keep the conversation going, but partly for my sake,
My name is Hawa, and I've been a human rights defender for about 20 years. And so I could relate to what Vanarase was saying. I was just at O when I heard all of you speak. And I'm here just looking at those villages in Congo and having passed through some of those spaces and having hoped that we have technology that could help us. I was defending women sentenced to death under Sharia, Islamic law, and I defended over 100 cases in northern Nigeria. But let me speak about what is an anniversary today, and that's my question actually. Today is the second year anniversary of over 200 girls that have been kidnapped by Boko Haram. Last year, I spent the year in Amman, Jordan. But in the meantime, in 2014, the president of Nigeria invited me to work on these issues of how to rescue those 200 girls. We were very fortunate to get a lot of technology, drones from Israel, from United States, from France, and from Britain. And we did discuss with some of the intelligence officers that came into Nigeria to work on this issue. 2 years after, most of the girls are still missing. And my question is, how can technology, and what is technology doing, but how can it really help us human rights defenders on the field try to see how we can solve some of these puzzles? And listening to you and really hoping I could glue onto some of you to see what can I learn to go back to the field and do it differently.
One thing that I would say right off the bat is technology is a pretty big buzzword, but it's not a panacea. It can't be applied to everything, and unfortunately, there aren't quick fixes to many of these problems. It's something that can generate a lot of energy, but I think it can also distract from approaches that might not have a tech solution to it. Or maybe even offer false hope in some instances.
Yeah, I would echo that exactly. Technology cannot replace political will, right? So, I mean, and that's what I think you're seeing with what Chris was talking about, is you could have all of this information, but the conflict is still going on, right? And so I think the same with what happened in Nigeria is, you know, even with all the technology, would those girls still be found? I don't know the answer to that, but I think that there is this element of political will and that we're not talking about, but I don't think that technology can solve that. And so there's this other aspect of political will, but also like accountability, which was asked before, and responsibility. And so I think those are three different topics, and we could have a whole conference about all of those. But it's I don't think you can replace that aspect of what you're looking for in terms of how do we find these girls. I think you could have more technology, but I don't know whether that would necessarily mean that you would have found them, if that makes sense.
I mean, I'll just say also, part of our work is funded by MacArthur Foundation, and one of the terms of our grant was to see if we could collaborate with their grantees in Nigeria. And we were just on a call with them like 2 weeks ago. The kind of calls we typically have where we say, we're designers, you're a human rights organization, how can we possibly work together? And we try and get all the kind of casework they're doing out on the table. And I would say it was one of the most difficult conversations to have in terms of figuring out a way forward. And I think specifically because of the dearth of information that's coming out of parts of Nigeria. I mean, they even talked about Boko Haram destroying, you know, cell towers and removing connectivity that was once there. And so we're looking for ways to work together and to better document human rights violations in Nigeria. But I'll say that it was the most challenging sort of, it wasn't clear how we were going to be able to do that together. We're going to continue to try.
Hi, I'm Aman Rahman. I'm a grad student here in the Technology and Policy Program. So my question is more in terms of, let's say we're to scale this model and have it for other conflicts. For instance, even in Pakistan, we have multiple, you know, Taliban groups, etc. What are the kind of resource requirements? I mean, it looks very resource intensive. A, should this kind of effort be spearheaded by the academia in different countries? Or do you think it should be human rights groups? Do they have the capacity to? And in terms of what you work on, how resource intensive is it? You know, what kind of team are we looking at? What kind of, you know, capital are we looking at?
This project is one of those 1% inspiration, 99% perspiration type projects. But I would say it's also, you know, 1-2% technology and the rest just pure manual labor. There's no artificial intelligence that can sort through videos and tell you what's in them or to geolocate them. So there are some tools that are being developed. People have been working with. Yeah, we're getting close. With Jay are really making progress in terms of analyzing large quantities of video, but it's it's really, really manual. And it's something that you really have to just kind of delve into. Just say, okay, I'm going to spend, you know, 8 hours today just looking through videos and sorting them and tagging them with whatever information you can. But I think with a good group of people, with microtasking, I would certainly engage civil society in this, you know, and we're engaging everybody that we can in Syria as well. You know, it's not just data that we're putting up on our website or reports that we're writing. We're going and we're talking to people and saying, you know, okay, this is what we understand is happening. Can you give us a little bit more context? Can you contribute to this? And there are quite a few people that do. One of the things that we're working on recently, when we released the front lines map, there's a little button down at the bottom that says contribute data if you have any. You know, and you can fill out a form and you can say, oh, your info in this place is incorrect, or this town was actually controlled by this person at this point. And we started to get a lot of feedback from the community. If you can create a forum that enables people to contribute to something, then you can get a lot of good at it. And like I said, you know, these videos and things that are being uploaded in Syria are not being uploaded just for fun. You know, they're not just to share with their friends or family. It's to get the word out. And if there's a lot of energy behind really understanding what's happening around you or trying to piece together these little puzzle pieces that come through YouTube or Facebook, then providing some sort of a forum for people to do so really, really helps.
Yeah, so I just want to say that it's important to remember that each data point there comes from an individual person or a group, and a lot of those people are trying to push the narrative in particular ways, but others just want to say, listen, this is what the Assad regime or this is what this group is doing to me and my family, and I want the world to know. So I think that you know, there's hope in that, in the sense that individuals make a difference in that way. But I think that the way to go about it in Pakistan or anywhere else is to engage existing networks of activists, family groups, tribal leaders, whatever the context is, you know, neighborhood associations, whatever the case may be, depending on where you are, and integrate technology through that mechanism rather than just expecting people to suddenly suck up a technology and use it. The other thing that I always tell people is take advantage of what's there. If you can, you know, people take video and put it on YouTube all the time. Does it allow for easy verifiability? No, it's a huge problem. You know, is it liable to takedown? Yes. Can it, you know, be taken and repurposed for other purposes? Yes. But it's simple and it's there and it's easy and everyone knows how to use it. So rather, you know, I think I get discouraged when I see how many new apps are being created every day. We were just at a meeting called RightsCon, a couple of us. And there, you know, I just discovered another new app for video capture. The ones that are existing already haven't even been taken up, and people are solving this problem like this is the problem. No, it's, you know, we need to build political will to take the information that's being gathered and do something with it. So I think, you know, being smart about recognizing that change doesn't happen from technology. Technology is a tool, and moving that way. I think, you know, the other thing is there is a lot of work that needs to be done on analysis of existing data. And I think that that's where the academic component is. I think we should, you know, I said at this meeting, there should be a moratorium on the development of new apps. Things like Metacapt accepted that have a particular purpose. There's just a lot of people saying, oh, I'm going to create a new app for gathering human rights evidence. And it's just, you know, what are we doing with this data? If it just sits, I mean, it discourages people when they document in a way that they think is going to make a difference and it doesn't. I think at least on YouTube, there's no sense that there's some like agency at the back of YouTube that's sucking the data out and like going out and prosecuting people. So I think that, you know, keeping expectations low, using existing resources, using existing technologies, and taking advantage of data that already exists, I think that's the way to make a difference rather than creating a shiny new toy or a tool. I'm so against that kind of approach. But it seems to be what gets people funded, unfortunately. So that's the discouraged me.